Do you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, so my name is Jaume, and I'm here to talk about what to do or how to start to be interested in Microsoft architecture technology and business process. Okay, so I'm a software engineer at Shifted. If someone doesn't know what it's Shifted, it's the company you have behind here in Spain, Segunda Mano, with the jobs, Fotocasa, Concepción, the Wuhan in France, BG or Blocket in Sweden and Norway, for example. So we have millions of users, so we handle, we have a lot of problems with monolithic applications and infrastructure running. So we start integrating our infrastructure to what microservice based infrastructure. So let me start with a quote from Adrian Kopra. It's when you're working with a distributed system, you have to assume that everything can go wrong. If someone has been here in the Drobit presentation, they said everything is safe. So if everything can go wrong, it will go wrong at some point. And the only reasonable thing to do is to be prepared. So with Shifted, we use AWS, and for people that are familiar with AWS know that for at some sometimes it does just die for no reason. Amazon just decides to do it. And so what happens if an instance dies or service dies? That's quite simple to solve. Don't question the service anymore. But what happens if instances get latent or for some reason they start to perform really slow? So how do we handle that? So at the time we did an exercise, so we need to migrate to microservices. So we could start from the beginning, from scratch, doing everything from our own, and face the same problem that other big companies had, like Netflix, Twitter, or Amazon. Or we can just learn from these companies and use something that is already battle tested and adapt it to our needs, So we choose Netflix OS. What does Netflix offer? Infrastructure as a service, caching, fetching, database, cloud environment, cloud infrastructure, building immutable infrastructure, continuous deployment, configuration management for the services, testing, monitoring, networking, robustness, security. So here are some companies from the current Netflix OS stack. All of these are open source for everybody to use. Obviously, I'm not going to talk about all of them. Not all of them are here. They didn't fit in the slide. So some services like Asgard, that you can use it for managing your cloud and continuous deployment, or Atlas for a telemetric and monitoring for your service. Priam for handling Cassandra clusters. It's really easy to do node finding, backup and recovery. The same for RIGA to do the same with Elasticsearch. Obviously, I'm not going to talk about all of them. I'm going to talk about Singleton, which are these ones, Ubiquitarian, Arcadius, Ribbon, Mystrix, and Singing Army, which I think they are the basics to start this kind of architecture in this ecosystem. So Eureka is for service discovery. Carrion would be like the Microsoft framework. Arcadius is for configuration management. Ribbon and Hystrix. Ribbon is for client load balancing, and Hystrix for fault tolerance strategy. And the last one on the list is in the Army for testing. Everything is working in the problem. So let's start with Eureka. Service discovery. So we're going to build a microservice architecture. We're expecting lots of microservices at our scale. So we need a way to find them automatically without carrying up URLs, anything. which port they are listening, which port they are listening, which is the IP, anything. So here comes Eureka. Eureka works in the EAP, in the CAP. If you know the CAP theorem, it says that in a distributed architecture, you cannot have consistency, availability, and partition tolerance at the same time. You just can't have two. So Eureka works in the IP, which is for availability and partition tolerance. So the availability, so you, it will always give a response, even if it's a subset of payload. And partition tolerance means that if there's some problem in the network, it will keep working. Okay, so instead of zookeeper that works in the CP, which is all data in the same, in all the nodes will be the same at the same time. And if there's a problem, you have a problem. Okay, so each service will register to Eureka automatically. It will register for load balancing and automatic deployments. And it will register with that parameter. There's a lot more, there's more, but this is the basic ones. A name in the service, so you can find it in the dashboard. The VIP, which is like a URL, so if you want to call from one service, you want to call to another, you just use this VIP. You will ask Eureka, give me all the instances with this VIP, and then you will load balance. Yeah, because this, in Netflix OSS, the load balancers are in the client, so you decide how you want to attack other services and how they have to perform. I will talk more about that. Okay, so also it offers an architecture of the market, but depending on how big you are, this architecture can change every 5 minutes. So it's like an alive system. Okay, so let's continue. Okay, I know how to discover them. How do I build them? Okay, the framework, Kerim. Kerim is a framework and a library that essentially contains the blueprint of what it means to implement a cloud version of service. Okay, very nice. So it offers bootstrapping, dependency lifecycle management, runtime insight diagnostics, configuration management via Chaos. I'll talk about the Chaos in the next slide. Service discovery in Eureka. And it uses a powerful custom model like RxNetty, and it uses RxJava for reputational programming. So basically, RxNetty is a record extension to Netty. So the Kerim can be dynamically configured using a Chaos. It registers itself in Eureka, and it handles all the handshake and all the heartbeats and everything. And it offers all the things you need to work in this ecosystem out of the box. Of course, you can decide not to use this, you can just plug another one. But everything is here, it's like a library, so you have a Eureka client, and Archive is also a library, so you can plug, if you don't want to use Kerim and you want to use, I don't know, another framework, you can use it. You just need to handle how to control the library. Using RxNetty and RxJava, it really simplifies how you deal with asynchronicity at HTTP level. RxNetty can work at a HTTP server, TCP server, and WebSockets, so Kerim can use the same thing. Okay, so now we have how to build the microservice. At some point, sometimes it's not just the only thing you need. So you have a really big architecture with a lot of instances. One service can have hundreds of nodes. Do I have to configure all of them one by one if I have a problem? No. Here comes the Chaos. Well, I don't like to put code in the slides, but this is how you start pairing. Just click. Like a Netty server. If you get this light, you will see that it's super easy. You start a server in a port, listen to a port, and just a handler. If you work with Netty, you know that you have some kind of handler. And order and a path. So here it's really, really simple. This is just a flow work. Conversion manager. Okay. So Archaeus offers dynamic typed properties. So you would get like a string if you find that property The other one is a default to the final. It offers high throughput and trace-safe compression operations, a callback mechanism, a properties change, you can be notified and react as you need. And out of the box, it offers composite configuration for applications. What does it mean? That you can define a hierarchy of your properties. For example, if you want that the database has a higher priority than a local property file or a runtime property, would that be fine? We'll see how it works, but you just need to, it's really simple, just a matter of lines that automatically everything will go. And you can do dynamic configuration using this, using URLs, so other APIs, or KDBC, Amazon DynamoDB, or any kind you want to plug in. But these ones that are here, they are out of the box. If you want to plug another one, you can also implement the interface. So how does it work? Here, I don't know if you see that in the fact. No, right? I think it's really okay. And just here at the top it says runtime configuration. At the after it says persistent database configuration, then application properties and libraries and configuration, etc. So what does it mean? That here the runtime configuration will have a hierarchy. So if you change the property in the runtime configuration, it will prevail on top of if you have a property in a database that is looked up every day. If you see here the persistent database configuration, it's long pooling every, I don't remember, it's 30 seconds or a minute, so it's every minute or 30 seconds, you just check if it changed. But if the properties in runtime, that will prevail instead of the one in the database. So with one line, so with single line you get a property that you want, and you don't care if the system property, if it's a system property, a file it comes from a file or from a database, or a chaos handles everything for you. So, and if a system, if it's a property change, you will get it there automatically in runtime. So now you know how to configure them and how to just start with the microservice in the Netflix hotel. But the main problem is we're a microservice, we're expecting to have a lot, we're gonna need to talk to them, we're gonna need to talk to each other. And that's a really, one of the main points or key points in failure. That's a network, request to the network, that's the thing that can blocks you from achieving good performance or the ones that are doing the request to you. So in a distributed environment, if you've been in Torvik, he's already explained a little bit his tricks this morning, so I'm gonna just go a little bit. I think I'm going to go a little bit more in detail, but it's more or less the same as this way. In a distributed environment, it's inevitable that many services that independent will fail. That's something that will happen. So Bistrix is a library that helps you control interactions between other services or third-party client libraries. And stop cascading failure in conflict with the system, fail file, and recover file, and offer a fallback and virtual integration if possible. And offers also a near real-time monitoring alerting and operation. So what does it mean? So, for example, imagine they have an application that depends on other third services, where each service has an uptime of 99.99. That's a lot, it's really good. Uptime here is what you can expect, is formula, so you get that it will be like 2 hours of downtime every month. But that's if all the services are 99.99, which in reality is what works. So what happens is if you get a request and everything goes perfect, good, no problem. But if one service starts to be latent, the request can, if you have 50 requests per second, all threads can be blocked in a matter of seconds. Okay, so all the queue we will pull waiting for that dependency. So all your system will just be shut down in a matter of seconds. So that's something we want to avoid. So what districts offer the solution for that. So okay. So I don't think you'll see it down in the back either. But what it offers is a way to, when you perform a request to another service, if something fails or it becomes latent, it will just reject it and go to forward, for example. So I have you guys see it here. It's a graphic of, this applies the circuit breaker pattern. So this is what circuit breakers do. I don't want you to learn this, so I'm just going to summarize it. If you do a request and it's already, and it's catched, you will just hit the catch. Okay, perfect. And if you do a request and the circuit breaker it's open, you will fall back automatically. And that fallback is something that you decide what to give in the focus. Okay? What does it mean the circuit is open? If you fail three times to request a service, then the circuit is open and you will stop sending traffic to that service for, I don't know, X seconds. That's up to you to decide. And normally by default it's 30 seconds. Okay. And if everything, if you can perform the request, then you do it. If it fails, then you fall back. If it timeouts, then you fall back. And if everything goes well, then you just get back your response. Okay. So what it means is, there is, even if there is a problem, you will respond something. Always. You will not get stuck waiting for the other finish. Okay. So all the, we go back to the other slide. Not all the queue will be waiting for you. Finish. They will just let you finish the request that you were doing, and it will, they will start giving doing new requests after you. Just after the service that was nothing. Okay, and this offers a dashboard like this. So here you can see from all the comments we have how they are performing and in real time or near real time. It's something like a second delay. So you see successes, the circuit is open, failures, timeouts, the average time to do a request, and obviously you can just do notifications to somebody. You see that it sees that there's some circuit open and start failing a lot, you can just get notified so you can get aware of it and keep track. Okay. So we have a way to protect ourselves from other services that we depend from, like that we need to make a request and they perform slow, it don't be a, so it don't affect us. So it doesn't affect us. And also, another thing you can be worrying is, okay, you claim this, but how do I call a service? Okay. So Netflix has a nice way of doing this, which is in every instance, you decide for the time. So you are the load balancer. So for all the dependencies you have, you'll have a load balancer for it. Okay? So load balancers are integrated with the client. You have a multi-protocol. It's multi-protocol, we can talk HTTP, TCP, UDP, supporting a synchronous and reactive model. You can plug any protocol you want, but that you have to do it yourself. Also, it's a matter of implementing an interface. Multiple and pluggable advanced rules, and we'll explain them later. It's integrated with service discovery, so it works with Eureka to contact other services. Uses configuration for direct client factory, so in a matter of properties in properties in a property file or in a database or whatever, you can define how you expect the other service to respond. I will show you for example. And since version 2, they offer caching and matching and fault tolerance. That's for pieces, but they got integrated in almost. Not one, but they work together really well. So, what can you do with this? It's a smart load balancer, balance to each dependency service in the client. So you decide how to connect to the service. It's going to be acceptable and unacceptable. Obviously, you cannot, if a service that you are doing a request takes at least 1 second, you don't expect that call will happen in less than 1 second. You have to be realistic. You have to do that. So how does this work? Imagine that you have an API gateway that has to talk to an account instance, a search instance, or a file instance. So you do a request, okay? It needs to talk to two services. Everything goes well, okay, no problem. But what happens if search instance starts failing? So you get another request, and search instance starts failing. Okay, what we don't want is that we give out 500 or something. We don't want to fail. Okay, so what it does ribbon for you is this. The instance is not responding on the performing value under your criteria. Then it will just jump to another instance in the line, in the queue. Or so if you have like 10 instances, you can specify if you want to jump to, you want to retry to 1, 2, 3, or the times you need, so it works. So the next, instead of giving a 500, you give the what you need. Okay. So this is from this. Okay. So yeah, the load balancer components. What are the components that you think that's good? How the rules you want to apply. So I want to do a round robin to all the services. So round robin. Availability filtering. So if you are working in Amazon, when you work in Amazon, you get like availability zones that your service can just start. So availability, you have like a three availability zones. If you are in Europe, it's ABC. So service will start in ABC. So if you do a availability rule, it will try to contact the closest one. So if your service is in the A, it will try to contact another service that's in the A. Or you can do a waiting response time rule, which that means that I didn't say that, but from each request is performed, you get a statistic. Ribbon keeps a statistic for that. So it knows which services are performing better or worse. So that's the waiting response time rule. We'll just try to request the service that is performing faster. And you can just do server list. The server list component, you just need, you just say, for example, the endpoints of the other API or static server list. So, for example, I want to talk to Google or Microsoft or whatever, the API, or you can use Eureka to talk to your service. So with a simple property, as I said, just a simple property, like, okay, the client JBC is on, but that was a microservice. I will try to reply to the same service one time. I will try, if it fails, I will try to jump to other services at least three times. A connection timeout is, these are random numbers, they are two. So a connection timeout is in 3,000 milliseconds, and root timeout, if it's higher than 3,000, I will try to scatter the connection. So that's how you configure root. That's super simple. And you see the line at the bottom that says deployment context is deep address. It will use the deep address that you registered in Eureka, just call your service with that address. Or you can just do all the servers. Okay, so now you know how to start with the microservice or in this kind of ecosystem, how to be protected and how to be resilient, but how to ensure that that's happening. That's why we have the seminar. It seemed like a joke, but it's not. We have a lot of of monkeys that does different stuff for you. Like a janitor monkey will clean the cloud for you. So it will just kill instances that no one is using and no one is doing requests for maybe a week or something. It will clean also Elastic IPs or files in S3 that are not used, or the security monkey that will look for violation. But here the important one is to know if you are resilient is the chaos one. Chaos monkey, chaos gorilla, and chaos monkey. So what does chaos monkey? Chaos monkey basically it just searches all your scanning groups and all the instances you have and they kill them in production. Basically that. Chaos phone, I chaos gorilla, the thing that it does the same, but it calls a full availability zone. So all the Euro 8 is down because after the golden time. And if you have chaos phone, it just kills the whole zone. So if you have services in the United States and Europe, it will just kill Europe and see all your traffic is automatically redirected to the United States. So you don't get a thing. Okay, so this running in production also kills databases. So for that. So the purpose is to have test how your system performs when everything fails. So when everything fails, you are prepared for it. Obviously, this is not done like a weekday at 9 in the morning, and then 9 in the night in prime time, right? Or like, same prime time. When you have more peak of users. This is by default, it's done in office time, just a week. Okay, so. So I've talked about Ethereum, Chaos, Eureka, Bistrix, Ribbon, and the CNRM. There's more, we can do many things. The only thing they want to do is Chaos. So the purpose with something that I didn't say is that with Bistrix and Ribbon, that's why they Netflix chip. Do continuous deployment and get rid of staging and development environments. Because what they do is you can imagine that you have a scaling group with hundreds of nodes or tens, whatever. So you want to deploy a new version, you just put a new version, one instance of the version, and then with the telemetric service that they have, it's called Atlas, for example, they just start collecting data of how this is performing. If this is performing bad, Ribbon will automatically just switch to another service that is from the old side. So even if this one fails, nothing will be affected. Everything will continue to work. And so they start collecting metrics in this one, and then they compare it to the old side. And your service can be performing well and working fine, but if it's not better than the old one, that's just fine. So you can just be really proud that you need that commit that seems to work fine, but it's not working fine. And that you know, like, in a matter of minutes, what you do is work fine. What you do just go back. I think that's everything you can call it. And this is it. Someone is interacting, we do regular meetups with talks and workshops, and we put them through here. So everybody is welcome to join. I think it's once a month, you know. And if someone is interacting, well, you can buy it, my email or something here. So, someone has any questions? Yeah. The recycle policy? Ribbon. Yes. No. Well, actually, since version 2, Ribbon 2, they are not one library, but they work really well together. They used to work really well together, but that's they changed the API so to make it much more simple, especially because before you have to control that, you have to extend from a Bistrix class, and then you have to put all the Ribbon inside, and And I would just a matter of, okay, this is my fallback, this is my retail policy, this is my service I wanted to do exactly. So, like, Rimini is the one that handles the request. That you configure. You can configure that programmatically or just in a property file. Let's say, like, okay, I want to reply three times in the same service, or one time in the same service and three times in another one is different.
Are you actually using all of these services in production?
Yes.
And what you're doing with them?
Good. I haven't. I can sleep a lot at night. If the service recovers themselves alone.